Let's see now the protective layers of the brain and the spinal cord. These layers are usually called the meninges. And basically, there are three layers of covering in both for the spinal cord and the brain. These are called the dura mater, the arachnoid mater, and pia mater. Mater means mother. So here we are looking at the brain. Okay, this is the bone, and this is the dura mater. Here it shows that the dura mater is made out of two layers. We will not go into that details. We consider them it's one layer. It's very thick layer and very tough fibrous connective tissue that is attached directly to the bones. So the dura mater is a very tough membrane that is attached directly to the bones. And in many cases, if we are trying to take the brain out of the skull, the dura mater would stay within the bone. Okay, would stay within the bone. So this is the first layer, fibrous connective tissue, very tough fibrous connective tissue. Beneath it, there is the arachnoid matter. Now, arachnoid, I think it's like a spider because of these structures, the trabeculae. So these would provide a space within this layer. This space is something called subarachnoid space. It's the space beneath the arachnoid matter. This space is important because, as you can see, this is an area for the blood vessels to run within. So the blood vessels are running to the subarachnoid space. Beneath it, there will be the biomatter. And the biomatter is a very delicate layer. It covers every single part of the nervous tissue, of the CNS. So it traps like a cellophane covering a product. It covers every single juries, sulcus, fissure on the surface of the spinal cord and the brain. This is the biomatter. So these are the three layers. Now the biomatter, protection-wise, is not as strong, of course, as the dura mater. Now, why do we need all of these protections? Because the nervous tissue is so soft, it's super soft, and it's easy to get damaged to the degree that if you take a brain out of a skull and put it, a fresh brain, and put it on the table, it will be damaged just because of its weight. Just because of its own weight, it will be damaged. To that much, the nervous tissue is super soft. Now, what about the spinal cord protection? We still have the three basic layers. We still have the dura mater, the arachnoid mater, and the pia mater. The dura mater, this is the dura mater, the arachnoid mater, and the pia mater in black. However, in addition to these layers, we have now more spaces. So, for example, we have the dura mater. Beneath it, there will be the subdural cavity. Over there in the brain, it wasn't like a great space that we usually like ignore it. It's not really a space. Whereas here in the spinal cord, no, this is an actual space. So there is subdural space. Then we have the arachnoid matter, and also there is the subarachnoid space or the subarachnoid cavity. Then we have the pia mater, and after the pia mater, we will have the nervous tissue itself. So for the brain, we have the dura mater, then we have the arachnoid, and we have the pia mater. And the only significant space is the subarachnoid space. That is for the brain. Here we have immediately the bones. There is no space between the bone and the dura mater, and there is no significant space between the dura mater and the arachnoid mater. However, for the spinal cord, there is the dura mater, there is the arachnoid mater, and there is the pia mater. Between the dura mater and the arachnoid mater, there is the subdural space. Between the arachnoid and the pia mater, we have the subarachnoid space. And technically, in the spinal cord, we have the vertebra, right? And between the vertebra, which is the bone, and dura mater, there is also a space. It's called the epidural space. This space is filled with fat, usually, whereas these spaces are filled with the cerebrospinal fluid, even here, this space. And these spaces are to provide areas for the blood vessels. So this is the spinal cord meninges. Now, for the epidural space, as we said, this is between the vertebra and the dura mater. So this is the space above the dura mater or before the dura mater. Usually, this is a space where the epidural injection during labor, so the needle will be inserted there and the anesthesia would be delivered into this area to reduce the pain. In case there is infection, sometimes within the meninges, there is a condition called meningitis, which is the inflammation. And usually, this is caused by bacterial or viral infection. And this is a very serious injury, because it can affect the mental state of the patient. In order to test that, we need to do a lumbar puncture and basically withdraw CSF, the cerebral spinal fluid, from this space from the subdural cavity. So the needle will have to go into this area and withdraw the CSF. So in case you came across this, now you understand what's going on. So let's talk about the CSF. For the CSF, this is a fluid that cushioning the nervous tissue, whether it's in the brain or in the spinal cord. This is mainly watery solution, but it has less protein and different ion concentration than blood plasma. It's also a medium where all of the wastes of the nervous tissue is released, but importantly, it's a protection tool for the brain. We said the brain is very soft tissue, so even if it hits the bones, like to the skull, it might damage it. So the brain technically is floating in a fluid in order to reduce the chances of hitting the brain or the nervous tissue against the skull. So this will slow down the movement of the brain, making it always floating, and this will prevent the strong movement or strong rotation of the brain that will cause damage to it just simply because it's hitting the skull. And in sports, like in American football, this is a serious injury, you know this, that can cause concussion. Simply why? Because the brain will get hit against the skull. Now, additionally, we said the cerebrospinal fluid is for protection. There is another layer of protection. This is something called the blood-brain barrier. And the blood-brain barrier, it's a layer of cells around the blood capillaries. As you can see, this is the blood capillary. We have these endothelial cells that forming the blood capillary. And then we have the ependymal cells. The ependymal cells and these endothelial cells act as a barrier, as a blood-brain barrier that would prevent things from passing simply to the cerebral spinal fluid. This area here is where the cerebral spinal fluid exists. Okay? So what's happening here, that this is an area where the metabolic waste are getting into the blood by diffusion or active transport, whereas the new nutrients, new ions, new oxygen, glucose, all of them coming to the CSF to be delivered to the brain. So these cells will act as a barrier that will prevent any unneeded materials to pass to the nervous tissue. And because of this, because of the blood-brain barrier, many of the treatments to brain diseases are failing because this is so strong barrier that will block most of the chemicals, but not all of them. So for example, any fat-soluble substance would pass. Alcohol, nicotine, and some anesthetic reagent will pass. Most of the proteins, most of the toxins like potassium ions, all of these will be denied to pass. The blood-brain barrier is absent in areas where there is a need of direct observation to the composition of the blood. Like for example, the vomiting center in the hypothalamus. There is always a need to check what type of chemicals in the blood. So in that case, the blood-brain barrier is absent. For the ventricles of the brain, you can think of them as spaces within the brain itself. These spaces are all filled with the CSF and they are continuous with the central canal. So this is one thing we did not mention when we talked earlier about the CSF, that it runs through the central canal. That's why if they need to check for the meningitis, they will withdraw the CSF from the spinal cord. It's much safer than withdrawing it from the brain. But it will be the same composition, because there is a circulation of the CSF. There is a circulation of the CSF between the brain and the spinal cord, which is something we don't really need to fully understand. Just understand that there is this circulation. So these ventricles of the brain, they contain the CSF. And we have four ventricles. We have two lateral ventricles. We connected together by a third ventricle, which lead to a fourth ventricle. This is the fourth ventricle, and which will lead to the central canal of the spinal cord. So you need to understand that the ventricles are spaces. So to visualize them, you can think that we take the brain with the CSF inside and freeze it, then take out all of the nervous tissue. You will end up with the frozen CSF that would match the ventricles. That will match the ventricles. And again, it's a way to reduce the weight of the brain, to support it, to make it float, since these are spaces. So I will stop here. When we come back, we will go through the rest of the chapter.